Thank you very much. The final item of business is indeed a member's business debate on motion 23746 in the name of Jackie Bailey on support for people with learning disabilities during the COVID-19 pandemic. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Can I ask those members who wish to speak in the debate please to press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Jackie Bailey to open the debate.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I am very grateful that my motion has made it to the Chamber before Parliament rises and we enter the election period. Whilst we will all undoubtedly be very robust in arguing about policies and the clash of debate will be vigorous, I'm sure, there are many areas, though, on which we can agree. And concern for people with learning disabilities is most definitely one of them. The issues that we're going to discuss tonight are, in my view, hugely important. And it is the duty of each and every one of us to give a voice to those who struggle to be heard. And there are few who struggle to be heard more than those living with a learning disability. The Chamber will be aware that I am the convener of the cross-party group on learning disabilities, and I work very closely with organisations like Enable Scotland and others to improve the position of those with learning disabilities across Scotland. I am assisted in that process by Joan McAlpine, who has been tenacious in her pursuit of COVID vaccinations for those with learning disabilities. And I thank her for that, and indeed her for her success in ensuring that they are included in category 6 of those to be vaccinated. As I said earlier, it is important that the voices of those with learning disabilities are heard in this chamber. The testimony of one Enable Scotland member who lives with a learning disability sums up the extent to which they've been let down in the course of the pandemic. And this is what they had to say. I feel like we've been the forgotten people of the pandemic. If it hadn't been for the online groups Enable Scotland put on, I would have had nobody. There are as many as 175,000 people who have a learning disability in Scotland, yet just 23,500 adults with a learning disability are known to local authorities. That means the majority don't receive any formal social care or support. Many of them who do receive support have had their care packages cut during the course of the pandemic. And inevitably it falls to family caregivers provide the vast majority of support to those with a learning disability. And, you know, it will come as news to no one that the pandemic has made their ability to provide care almost impossible. The issue of access to care was reflected in a report from the Fraser of Allender Institute published earlier this month. And let me quote from it. The COVID-19 pandemic has been detrimental to the support relied on by people with learning disabilities. Some of this has been the result of restrictions on face-to-face contact, and given the heightened risk that people with learning disabilities face, in many cases, this was simply unavoidable. However, there can be no doubt about the harm this has had on people and their families. The heightened risk that COVID-19 presents to people with learning disabilities was also highlighted in distressing data published by the Scottish Learning Disability Observatory. People with learning disabilities in Scotland, they found, are twice as likely to test positive for COVID-19, three times as likely to die from the virus than those without a learning disability. However, despite those harrowing statistics, it has proven near impossible for staff who work with people with learning disabilities out with care home settings to be seen as a priority for receiving the vaccine. Staff have been put in the position of having to choose between withdrawing care or putting those they care for at risk. And last year has not only presented a serious threat to the physical health of people with learning disabilities, but it's had a huge impact on their mental well-being too. Enable Scotland launched a well-being helpline for individuals who have a learning disability during the pandemic. It's taken over 500 calls to date, and the number rises each and every week. However, beyond forensic mental health services, there is currently no specialist therapeutic mental health service for people with learning disabilities. And I have to say, that service is designed to overcome the difficulties that the pandemic presents to mental health. I'm sure that colleagues across the chamber will join me in calling for more investment in mental health services, and in particular, specialist mental health services for children and adults with a learning disability as we begin to move out of the pandemic. We know we only spend about 8% of our health service budget on mental health services, whilst in England and Wales, it's 11%. So clearly there is room for us to do better. Presiding Officer, I want to touch on another issue that has caused additional fear and anxiety for people with learning disabilities and their loved ones during what is already an extremely worrying time. In April 2020, during the first wave of the pandemic, members of the Learning Disability Cross-Party Group approached the Scottish Government with concerns about the use of do not resuscitate forms. Members were assured at the time that disability, including a learning disability alone, is not ever a reason for completion of a DNR form. Scottish Government claimed that it was updating clinical guidance, yet the lived experience of people with learning disabilities and their families show that there is still a great deal of confusion surrounding DNR guidance and protocol. So it's vitally important that the guidance is clarified, that there's no room for confusion, and the government must urgently ramp up its reporting and monitoring on the use of these orders for people who have a learning disability during COVID-19. We need an action plan which ensures that professionals, families, and crucially, people who have a learning disability have accessible information about the guidance and what it means for them. All of these issues, I hope, will be considered in the course of a public inquiry into COVID, looking at the impact on different people in our community. Presiding Officer, as I wrap up, I want to be clear that COVID-19 is not the start and end of the barriers that those with learning disabilities face. It's merely added to the many daily barriers that this community have to overcome. They experience inequality in many areas of their daily lives. Pandemic is not responsible for their struggles, but it has made a bad situation even worse. It is the responsibility of each of us to improve the day-to-day lives of those living with a learning disability now and in the future. And there is an opportunity for us to do so. Let's commit now to the creation of a Commissioner for People with Learning Disabilities. Let's make it our ambition that the next Parliament makes early progress to ensure that their human rights are very much at the centre of everything we do. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call Joan McAlpine to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I congratulate Jackie Bailey on securing the debate? And can I also take the opportunity to say how much I have enjoyed working with her on the Cross-Party Group for Learning Disability and commend her work with the group and leading the group, and also to thank everyone involved in the group, including the Secretariat and Able, for the fantastic work they do. Since the beginning of the pandemic, as Jackie mentioned, I have been raising issues about the needs of learning disabled people, and I'm pleased that progress has been made with regard to vaccination and testing. Although I do want to raise the issue of testing for young people, I received a letter just today from the father of a 17-year-old girl with Down syndrome in my South Scotland region, who was told to shield but who hasn't been vaccinated. And despite repeated calls to both the helpline and the GP, her dad has no information as to when she's going to get the vaccine. And of course, Down syndrome people were high priority in Group 4. So I would appreciate any guidance the Minister could offer in that regard. As well as being Deputy Convener of the CPG, I'm the legal guardian of my sister, who has Down syndrome and who does not have capacity to make decisions for herself. And that shapes how I look at these issues, because it's people who cannot speak up for their own needs who have been hurt most by this pandemic. All people without capacity often rely more on their family members, and it's really important that their carers and family members are listened to. One of the issues that particularly affects that group of people is the loss of day services, and in particular, building-based day services. For many people who use these services, it's like going to work or school, but it's also their community. It brings routine, stimulation, safety, friendship. And before the second lockdown, many day services all across Scotland were still not operating when pubs, schools, restaurants and sport were up and running. The replacements offered to people for the day services that were shut down were completely inadequate. Colouring packs, chats on Zoom, if you were lucky, and it's had a devastating effect on people. And I want to endorse the briefing from the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland on the need for better mental health services designed for people with learning disabilities as we come out of the pandemic. In local authorities all around Scotland, the families of learning disabled people who use day services have asked me where the day services workers went, particularly if they're run by local authorities. In many cases, these workers appear to have asked to be stayed at home, or they've been redeployed to deliver other council services. I know of one supported living facility which houses 9 people, most of whom went to a day centre about 4 times a week. And yet that's been absent for a year. And yet the replacement service is about 4 hours a week if you're lucky. So there's been no extra resource given to that supported living facility. And that's replicated all around Scotland. I think that it has to be said, and I've made this point before, that many parents of these people feel that a national care service where learning services for learning disabled people are controlled by local authorities won't work. I've spoken to third sector workers who point out that the services that they've offered learning disabled people during lockdown, and particularly when lockdown was eased last summer, were far more creative and imaginative, while the councils failed to come up with any alternatives to the closed adult resource services. The Scottish Government has, as the Minister said during our last debate on this subject, talked about working towards a transformation plan. And the Minister, in her closing speech, said that she was developing that transformation plan in partnership with the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, and that it would take a human rights-based approach. I think that will concern some of these families in despair at the loss of day services, because they're concerned that council social work departments will use this opportunity to further destroy day services, in particular building day services. And their experience of the redesign of services is the destruction of day services, which are not actually considered fashionable. And I'd just like to quote from one parent from East Kilbride, who is typical. He's the father of a woman in her 30s. She absolutely loved attending the Murray Owen Centre, and he believes that's now under threat. And I quote him, he says, "I know there are people in positions of power and influence who would, in effect, close the day centre model to our learning disabled community. A senior social worker actually said to me at a review meeting 12 years ago, when we strove to increase our daughter's package from 2 days to 4, said, 'Is that all you want for her, to be stuck in a day centre?' We were horrified by her question, which was asked in front of members of staff who transformed our daughter from being a shrinking violet with zero confidence into the confident, sociable, happy and far more able young woman she is today. Such offence and disrespect towards us and towards the staff of the centre necessitated a firm rebuke." So I really hope that in terms of looking at future services for young and middle-aged adults who attend day services and building day services, that we will listen to all groups, including carers, because I really appreciate the fact that the Minister is consulting people, organisations such as People First, and organisations that represent, allow people to speak for themselves. But the needs of people with very mild disabilities, whose focus is quite understandably getting into work and independent approach and total equality, is very, very different from people with more severe disabilities. And I think it's important that everybody's included. Self-directed support is great for some people, but not for everyone. And in fact, for people with the greatest need, there actually isn't the breadth of facilities to purchase through self-directed support. And I hope that the Minister will keep that in mind in terms of her discussions on the future of services going forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I call Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Shona Robertson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Jackie Bailey for bringing this debate forward this evening? And can I acknowledge the hard work that she has done chairing the cross-party group and raising many of these issues, along with Joe McAlpine, who has co-chaired it. It's been my privilege to be a part of that cross-party group and to watch the work that they have done. I think this is a really important debate that we are having this evening. And in the time before me, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'd like to make three very brief points, which have been made by others, and I'm sure will be made by others as we go on in this debate. But I think it is really important that they are heard and that we respond collectively as a Parliament to them. I want to thank Enable, Scotland and others who have provided briefing papers for tonight's debate. And as Enable Scotland point out, 31% of people with learning difficulties are looked after by a family carer. We have seen through this particular crisis the hours that those families have got cut, perhaps understandably initially, but there is a big concern that these hours will never be brought back or will be used in a different way. And I think it is vitally important that all parties commit to making sure that those who had particular hours for care within a family situation are kept and restored as soon as they can be. Families have been put under immense pressure over the last 12 months. The care for someone adds to that pressure, and that should be recognised, and local authorities and Scottish Government need to make sure that that help is there going forward. The second issue I would like to talk about is the support that people have within the community. As Jo McIver pointed out in her speech towards the end, there is a real concern within her area, and I know within my own region, that some of the community projects that people have been going to for many years are going to be cut or even got rid of completely. There is a view around amongst some that these community centres, these places of work, of leisure, are no longer appropriate and all care should take place within the house or in other forms of the community. Now, clearly there needs to be a mixed economy, but I am generally concerned, having spoken to a number of third sector charities within the Lothian region, that these centres are to be closed or funding is to be cut in such a way that they will no longer be viable. I've spoken to people who have different learning difficulties. This is their community. This is often their workplace. This is often the place that they get support, often the place they can only go during the week. To close these down would be short-sighted and would affect the most vulnerable in our society. And I do hope COSLA, Scottish Government, each local authority will consider very carefully the decisions that they make over these next few years. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, the area I think has caused me most concern out of this pandemic for those with learning difficulties has been do not resuscitate orders. And the use that I have come across of some of them by doctors. Again, I understand Scottish Government want to clarify the situation and want to make sure that the appropriate guidelines are in place. And I do hope that whatever inquiry takes place after this, this will be one of the key issues. We cannot have families worried about what is going to happen to their loved ones if they go into hospital. We cannot go back to the situation which unfortunately has occurred in the last 12 months, where a doctor thinks they know better and there is no consultation with family. Now, I know, I am sure, again, across different parties, there is a consensus on this, but we must work together to make sure that doctors and others within the medical profession understand what the guidelines are and that they are followed very clearly. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, can I again thank Jackie Bailey for not only bringing forward this debate tonight, but for all the work she and her cross-party group have done in the last 5 years. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Shona Robson to be followed by Maurice Corrie. Ms. Robinson, we're not hearing your sound. If you maybe give us a moment and then start again in a second. Shona, I don't know if you can try again. Shona Robinson. No, I'm afraid we're not hearing you just now, but we'll go to Maurice Corrie and then we'll come back to you in a couple of minutes. Maurice Corrie.
Deputy Presiding Officer, thank you very much indeed for allowing me to speak in this debate. Can I thank Jackie Bailey for her unstinting support for the subject of this debate and also for the learning disabilities sector. It is an enormous amount of work I know she does, and I commend her for it. I'm luckily a member of the cross-party group for dyslexia, though we have some similar characteristics in that as well, and I have a deep interest in it. My concern is, and I'm really concerned at the moment, is that the local authorities, the education authorities around Scotland are not really understanding the need for learning disability support in further and higher education. And I have had cases where reported to me where learning support and disability support teachers or lecturers have actually been not replaced when they come to retirement. So this is a real concern, and I hope the minister will pick up on this. As I say, also in my time when I was the shadow spokesman for community safety and visiting prisons, I saw the amount of work that's been done there to help prisoners in relation to rehabilitation and learning support and learning disabilities, where we have a high percentage, sadly, of people who are in prison who have suffered a lot of learning disabilities and not had received support from that, either in primary education, indeed secondary education. But I think in Scotland, we have an issue here in further and higher education, and I'd like to bring that to the attention in this debate. And to the minister, hopefully, will pick up with that. But as I say, in conclusion, I'd like to thank Jackie Bailey for bringing this members' debate to Parliament tonight. It is a very, very important area because so often we miss talent that is out there with a little bit of support and helping parents to understand too how they can support their children and their family, but also they need to be supported by the authorities concerned in Scotland. So I commend this to the Minister tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And finally, I call Shona Robinson.
Hello, Presiding Officer, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you loud and clear.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking Jackie Bailey for bringing today's members' debate to Parliament, which raises a number of important issues. We've all been affected by COVID-19. However, as others have said, it's important to recognise that some will have been affected more than others. Research by the Fraser of Allender Institute notes that people with learning disabilities are far more likely to suffer with underlying health conditions and multiple comorbidities, which are risk factors for the severe health outcomes associated with COVID-19. The Institute also notes that given this, it's safe to assume that those suffering from learning disabilities will have been adversely impacted by the pandemic. And I believe that Government has and is taking a number of welcome steps to address this issue and other concerns. Only last week, the Chief Medical Officer confirmed the First Minister's commitment that people with a mild or moderate learning difficulty would be vaccinated as part of Priority Group 6, whereas previously this group only included individuals with cerebral palsy, severe or profound learning disabilities, or Down syndrome. So the inclusion of those with mild or moderate learning disability is certainly a welcome one. The First Minister and the Chief Medical Officer have also made it clear that nobody in any circumstances should be pushed into signing do not resuscitate forms. And that's a very, very important, and Jackie really was right to raise concerns about that. Today, the Scottish Government published its research report, Coronavirus COVID-19 Disabled People Health, Social and Economic Harms, which also looked at COVID-19 mortality rates and people with learning disabilities. The Learning Disabilities Observatory research quoted by the report shows that overall, people in the learning disabilities population were more than three times more likely to die from COVID-19 than those in the general population. In response to the findings of the report, the government has committed to publishing data on COVID-19 deaths by disability status in Scotland in March, which I welcome. Perhaps the Minister can use today's opportunity to provide an update on this welcome commitment and highlight what other steps the government is taking to protect those with learning disabilities from COVID-19 and the associated impacts on their lives. The steps that have been taken so far to recognise and respond to those the concerns of those with learning disabilities have been welcomed across the board, and I do believe demonstrate a sincere determination to do everything that's possible to understand and limit the adverse effects of this pandemic on our most vulnerable groups. That's not to say we can't do more. The Scottish Government has said it will hold an inquiry into the pandemic in order to learn the lessons in how it dealt with the current pandemic and to inform how it reacts to any future public health emergencies. And I would certainly urge the Government to include groups and individuals who represent the concerns of those with learning disabilities in this inquiry, to listen to their voices and to put their voice at the heart of any future strategy. I understand that many groups have had concerns, not only over the direct health impact to those with learning disabilities, but concerns over the impact of emergency legislation on their human rights, the reduction in outside support and the financial consequences of the pandemic. And I would urge them to make their voices heard to any future inquiry. And finally, Presiding Officer, I hope that we can see a clearer roadmap out of the current situation emerge as announced by the First Minister today. All of us can now look to the future with renewed optimism. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I now call on the Minister, Claire Hockey, to respond to and wind up the debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would like to thank Jackie Bailey for providing us with a further opportunity following the members' debate last week to discuss the experiences of people with a learning disability during the pandemic. I'm acutely aware of the impact of the pandemic on people with learning disabilities. Our regular meetings with key charities and with People First have allowed us to respond very quickly, and we have provided additional support and funding, for example, £56,000 to a range of learning disability organisations to help reduce social isolation in winter, £115,000 to PAMS and Down Syndrome Scotland to support unpaid carers, and £30,000 to Down Syndrome Scotland and Enable to support siblings and parents of those with Down syndrome and vaccination support for people with learning disabilities. And I want to thank the organisations we are working with for their flexibility and their dedication. I'll now turn, if I may, to the specific points raised in the motion. Jackie Bailey mentioned data, specifically the need for COVID-specific data on the infection and mortality impact on people with learning disabilities. We announced on the 4th of February that the Scottish Learning Disabilities Observatory had published a high-level summary of their COVID data, and a preprint of the full report was made available on the 9th of February. This data showed that people with learning disabilities were more than three times more likely to die from COVID-19 than people without a learning disability. Any death is regrettable as it represents a unique and irreplaceable individual whose loss is mourned by many. And we've agreed with the Scottish Learning Disability Observatory that they should continue to collect and analyse data for the duration of the pandemic. Ms Bailey also mentioned the wider research that the Scottish Government commissioned from the Observatory last year on health for both children and adults with learning disabilities. And this research confirmed that there is still a 20-year disparity in mortality for adults with a learning disability, many of whom die in their early 50s and often due to preventable causes. For children, the position is more complicated with further work required. And last year, the Observatory hosted a successful roundtable discussion with leading clinicians to further explore the evidence and agree actions. And a roundtable on adults will take place next month. A priority under our proposed new plan for learning disabilities and autism is to make further specific progress on health outcomes. There is no one solution. It will take a range of coordinated actions, including further training across health and social care workforces and working with primary care on annual health checks. And the latter is currently being piloted in Aberdeen and led by learning disability nurses working with a local practice. We're determined to build support to tackle health inequalities as a fundamental human right. And this brings me to the concerns regarding the awareness and use of do not resuscitate forms, as mentioned by several participants in the debate for people with a learning disability. I want to make it absolutely clear that the Scottish Government values the lives of people with a learning disability as we do any other life. COVID-19 has brought no change to our advice on the use of do not attempt CPR. A learning disability should never be a sole reason for considering whether someone would benefit from CPR. Our ethical advice and support framework, published on the 29th of July 2020, emphasises this and makes clear that health conditions or disabilities that are unrelated to a person's chance of benefiting from treatment must not be a part of a clinician's decision-making regarding accessing treatment. And finally, the motion picks up on prioritising vaccinations for people with a learning disability and routine COVID testing for staff supporting people out with care home settings. On vaccinations, members are now aware that the First Minister announced on the 22nd of February that in Scotland, in consultation with the Chief Medical Officer, we would vaccinate everyone with a learning disability in Group 6. And this is currently taking place. And we've also written to NHS boards and health and social care partnerships to underline the key role of learning disability nurses in this programme. On staff testing out with care homes, we have made significant progress, and we will soon be expanding the availability of COVID-19 testing to frontline staff in other settings, including learning disability settings and a range of other settings. Presiding Officer, if I may turn to a couple of points made by members during the debate. Both Shona Robertson and Jackie Bailey mentioned the Fraser of Allender Institute report, which was published yesterday on employment opportunities for people with learning disabilities. They may be interested to know that last week I met with Jamie Hepburn, MSP, the Minister for Business, Fair Work and Skills, on this very issue. And I asked for a focus on improvement in employment outcomes for people with learning disabilities, improvement in data collection and capacity building with employers. And I want to assure the Chamber that I'm committed to working across ministerial portfolios to improve the life chances and employment opportunities for people with learning disabilities. Joan McAlpine spoke about a concern that has been raised with her by a constituent. We have funded, as Scottish Government, Down Syndrome Scotland to support families with shielding and vaccination queries. However, if Ms McAlpine wants to write to me regarding the specific details of her constituent, I will certainly endeavour to help her. And there was also mention of the Commissioner for Learning Disabilities and Autism. The Towards Transformation Plan that the Scottish Government is working on with COSLA will explore further the proposals for a commission or commissioner to protect people's rights. And over recent weeks, I've met with the three key organisations who have called for a commissioner. And today, in fact, I met with autistic people's organisations, both and individuals with learning disability and autism, to discuss this very issue. And we will continue those conversations. Finally, as members know and I've just referenced, we've been working with COSLA on the Towards Transformation Plan that pulls together our learning from the experiences of the pandemic and the input of key stakeholders, autistic people and people with learning disabilities. The plan takes a human rights approach. We don't yet know the full legacy and impact of the pandemic, but we're able to use what we know now to take some priority actions. And those priorities include improving physical and mental health, progressing the Morgan Report and Action Plan for additional support needs in schools, a review of supported employment, and following the publication of the Independent Review of Adult Social Care in February, our announcement about a new community living change fund of £20 million, which will deliver a redesign of services for people with a learning disability. I also want to mention and welcome the publication of the report of the Human Rights Task Force. Its recommendations will result in a world-leading framework that brings together for the first time in Scotland internationally recognised human rights in one place. In closing, Presiding Officer, as discussed last week, we've committed to explore further the proposals around a commission or commissioner to help protect people's rights. I had a valuable experience this morning listening to people with lived experience, and that will certainly play into our thinking as a Scottish Government. It would be worth mentioning that Councillor Curry from COSLA was also in attendance at that meeting. Presiding Officer, I'd like to again thank Jackie Bailey for bringing forward this motion and for the opportunity to have this debate. And I want to thank all the members across the Chamber for their contributions.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes the debate on support for people with learning disabilities during the COVID-19 pandemic, and I now close this meeting.